Hello and welcome to this special edition of Market Guru. Joining me today is Anup Maheshwari of DSP BlackRock. Thanks very much, Anup. Indeed, a pleasure to have you on the show. Thanks for taking time out to speak to our viewers here on Bloomberg TV India. My first question, Anup, how is the situation looking to you right now? How is the market looking to you right now?
Well, it continues to be a bit of a patience game, Vivek, as far as we can see markets. You know, we've spent the better part of the last 4 or 5 years in a range now, and the range has actually narrowed in the last couple of years. It still continues to be a sort of market where we're waiting for some structural trend to develop, but it looks like it'll still take a little bit of a while. So we're looking at a few fundamental improvements potentially to happen before we can get more structurally positive. But in the meantime, you know, you will continue to see markets trading in a range, and there will be enough, I think, stock specific opportunities that will keep coming away, just like has been the case for the past few years as well.
Anup, I was just going through a June 30th dated equity market outlook, which, you know, your team has put forth, and I just want to pick up a few points from there and get your perspective on those things. The first point that is made is it talks about how the MSCI India seems to have certainly done better than it did in 2011. It certainly seems to be doing better than some of the other comparable indices of other countries. How would you rate India's performance vis-a-vis some of the other companies? Because global capital is going to chase, you know, several other markets as well. How do you see India poised in comparison to some of its other peers in the Asian region?
Well, India has done pretty well year to date, and clearly that's also come on the back of a fairly poor quarter at the end of last year. So we were actually lagging at the end of last year, and we've made up for that and done quite well on a year to date basis. So in that sense, you know, the market's not done too badly this year so far. It would have been, I guess, better if the rupee had held up, but nonetheless, in local terms, it's been a fairly decent market so far. The interesting trend, clearly, though, Vivek, in the middle of all of this, is that you know, flows into India have been the strongest by far relative to virtually any other emerging market. India has received, you know, close to 2/3 of the flows into regional markets, and you know, it's interesting considering the fact that we continue to have so many issues on the ground here. So I think the fact is that you know, there is interest in the market at some level. As I said, it's a stock picker's market more than anything else. I think that's one area where India does stand out, just the range of sectors that investors potentially have to choose from. Unlike some of the other economies, let's say like Brazil or Russia, which tend to be more commodity centric, or China, which is facing its own set of problems now. So I think from a relative corporate governance standpoint in the larger companies, coupled with the choice available, you know, India still continues to be somewhere on the radar for international investors. All we need to do is, you know, do a few things right, and you know, I'm sure there's potentially enough money that would be interested in investing here. But really, it's the ball's in our court as far as you know, putting in the right policies and attracting investor interest is concerned.
That's a very important observation you make, Anup, because 2/3 of the flow coming into India, that's significant considering there's been otherwise a fairly gloom and doom kind of a scenario. What, if you could elaborate a little bit more on what, according to you, could have prompted this? Because there is one school of thought which says this is very short-term ETF kind of money. There's another school which says that, you know, we are valuation-wise not all that cheap. So how would you explain this sense of on the ground where things haven't really changed for the better that much as they should be? And I'll come to the point you made about what we need to get right. But first up, how would you explain this buoyancy among foreign investors of putting in this kind of money into India?
Well, you know, if you actually evaluate the flows, the first thing that strikes you is that clearly a large amount of the flows came in the first few months of the year, which is when the market started recovering as well. So that was coming on the back of poor performance in the last quarter last year, as I mentioned to you earlier. So therefore, there was some sort of interest just on that factor. But beyond that, we have seen in more recent months some fairly big transactions taking place where some large institutional holders or large sort of positions, particularly in the financial services sector, some ownership has come out into the market through placements, and a lot of that has been taken up by foreign institutional investors as well as domestic institutional investors. So there's been a bit of a change in ownership also in certain large financial services listed companies, which has also net added, therefore, in terms of the FI flows, even though it may not have come directly in the form of purchases on the screen, you know, in the normal course of the market. It's been more in the form of blocks and placements. But nonetheless, the fact is that for good quality companies, there continues to be strong interest. And that's the really important point to highlight. The other aspect of this flow clearly is, you know, when we, from whatever data we have, it's not just ETF flow, which is only focused on just owning the asset and then, you know, could change very quickly. I think to some extent, this is clearly a link to emerging market allocations or global market allocations. So this is allocation money, I think, that is dominating the flow of capital into India at the moment. Clearly, it just tells you that India does stack up somewhere relative to other options. I mean, at this point in time, the general mood globally is everybody seems to be more bearish on their own markets. So, you know, US investors are more bearish on the US than any other market. You know, Indian investors are more bearish on India than most other markets. And, you know, that's pretty much the scenario everywhere. So I guess, you know, you've got to see things in a relative sense. From that standpoint, Indian corporates aren't doing all that badly, at least a section of them, even though from a macro standpoint, things are not looking great. But, you know, it's pretty much the case everywhere in the world. So to that extent, I think there continues to be interest to invest on a bottom-up basis, at least into good quality businesses that are continuing to grow as far as India is concerned.
So let me come back to the point that you made earlier, Anoop, the two or three things that we need to do right. What, according to you, would those two or three things be? Just to add to that, you know, we hear a lot about bring FDI in retail, big ticket items such as those. But do you think somewhere there are more basic things which can be easily done, project execution, kickstarting investments? Is that, according to you, the bigger measures that need to come out of the government?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's clearly more on the ground things that need to get sorted out. So essentially, the environment has to be more corporate friendly. I think that's the basic point. You know, in the last couple of years, for whatever reason, it seems to have become fairly, you know, difficult for corporates to proceed with their investment plans. You know, approvals are taking a long time. There are all sorts of hurdles coming through, lack of certainty. And for any corporate, you know, when you're making large-scale investments, you need to have some clarity on, you know, your investment cycle and, you know, getting your project on stream. I think it's just those very simple issues that need to be addressed. I think what you need essentially at the heart of all of this is, you know, a focus on, by pretty much all the entire government machinery, hopefully, on trying to boost economic activity and facilitate what corporates are doing, rather than to be, you know, at odds with each other or have conflicting standpoints on various issues. So I think it's more the sort of the lack of, you know, a single directional focus that's really coming in the way of corporate investments at the moment, and that clearly affects the whole confidence and the investment climate. I think the bigger reforms, like you mentioned, you know, things like FDI, etc., again, are they send out the right signals, but they're obviously not something that's going to turn around the economy in a hurry. Those are more longer-term structural points. I think what we really need is just sorting out some of the on-the-ground issues, boosting corporate confidence, doing things positive for corporates rather than putting more hurdles in their way, particularly in a slowdown situation.
How bad, Anoop, is the situation on the ground? We've seen a fairly disastrous quarterly result. Many experts argue and say that the next quarter is probably going to be even worse, and it's only going to be another two quarters by the time we're actually going to see some kind of revival, provided, of course, the caveat being all that you outlined, that the government does all of that. How concerned are you about corporate health at this point of time? We'll talk about sectors in just a bit, but more from an earnings point of view, are you sticking to the kind of earlier projections that you or your team had of 10 to 12% earnings growth, or have you cut that down sharply?
No, we're still sitting at the same projection. And I've got to say, actually, the first quarter was on balance, if I just look at it very objectively, was actually a bit of a pleasant surprise from what we were anticipating going into the quarter. I think we were expecting it to be a lot worse, to be honest. But it's turned out to be a little better. And you know, clearly, again, it's very mixed results. So it's not that every company has done relatively well. And we have seen the larger companies on balance have actually produced more growth than the broader set of companies, which implies that there are challenges as you go down the market cap chain. But the fact of the matter is that if you just look at the constituents of our index and account for the fact that let's say financials are 25% and a large part of that is private sector financial companies, similarly consumer could be close to 10-11%, pharmaceuticals another 5-odd%, and technology is again another 13-13%. And these are all fairly steady businesses that even in the worst of assumptions should probably deliver some degree of decent growth. I think when you put it all together, combined with the negative effects in a large part of the other of the corporate sector, I think when you put it all together, you do come out with a base rate of growth of about 10-odd%. So, our assumption is that things will be pretty slow from a macro standpoint. The GDP numbers are going to get a little worse. But as far as corporate profits are concerned, I think we seem to have a bit of a base established at about a 10% growth rate, unless the whole consumption cycle itself slows down dramatically. So our feeling is, therefore, 10 to 12% seems to be on track. The first quarter clearly was not all that bad. We've got to see subsequent quarters, and I think the closest eye is on the financial services sector in terms of any further deterioration in their quality of assets. I think that's really the key focus here to determine when, the market as a whole starts feeling or, gets more comfort on this whole corporate, slowdown coming to a bit of an end and a bit of an improvement in the economic environment. So our sense is, like I started off right at the start, it's a bit of a patience game. It'll take a couple of quarters. But we seem to be going through a phase where we're troughing out rather than, decelerating or deteriorating further. So in that sense, it's good. I think we're in that phase now where, the markets will continue to consolidate and hopefully some sort of base is getting built up for a more structural trend somewhere down the road.
I just want to take on a little bit further on the whole banking financial piece, Anup, because when I go through the portfolios of many of your schemes, and some of them are the best performing schemes in the market, there is perhaps in every scheme the highest weightage is to banks and financials. And perhaps it's in line with the point you made that that's really the index construct as well. You said you're going to be keeping a close eye. What is your own sense? How bad is the problem according to you? Because again, there are two views there. One view which says, it's all right, things are a matter of concern, but they'll get okay. And then there is the other view, which is far more negative, which says you haven't seen anything yet. What would therefore you be doing when it comes to this sector?
Well, I think things aren't good at the moment, clearly. I mean, when we speak to companies like rating agencies, etc., who track non-performing loans or the quality of assets, and downgrades versus upgrades, I think it's quite evident that we're still in that process of downgrades. And actually the situation is a bit like it was in 2001-2002 at the moment. That's the level of stress in the system at this point. But it's a lot of this is linked to, let's say, dominance of one sector. So for instance, power is a major constituent of this. And therefore, if you start seeing some policies coming through that make it clear in terms of power sector reform or addressing some of the issues that exist with state electricity boards, I think then that picture can start improving somewhere down the road. And a lot of these, to our mind, won't necessarily eventually culminate in terms of becoming bad assets or that have to be fully written off. But, you know, they just have to go through this whole process of restructuring, be given some time before, you know, things get back to normal. So it's more of a, I think it's a sort of time correction of the quality of your portfolio more than, you know, walking into very big shocks and big write-offs. I don't think, we're definitely not anticipating that scenario yet. So our sense is it's just going to be a long-run process where, you know, restructurings might continue and time will be sought, and then eventually, you know, over a 2-3 year cycle, you know, time will be given for some of these assets to get sorted out, and hopefully cash flows will start coming back. But you know, clearly we're not at the end of that cycle yet. We're still somewhere in the middle of it, and therefore the next couple of quarters become quite important to assess whether it's significantly deteriorating or it's stabilizing. So that's the perspective that we had. But you know, at least the good part is on the private sector bank side, and or let's say in terms of retail assets within any bank, whether it's public sector or private sector, at least on that front, things seem to be holding out reasonably well so far. And as I said, although banking and financial services is 25% of the index, a large part of that is actually the private sector, where you don't have as much of asset quality concerns as in some of the public sector banks. So that may not impact the market as a whole as dramatically.
What about the whole defensive space, Anup? FMCG, pharma, many would argue that their valuations are now too rich. Would you still stick with a defensive posture, or would you be moving away to taking a little more risk with a 2-3 year kind of a time frame? What would your stock picking strategy be at this point of time?
Well, with a 2-3 year time frame, Vivek, clearly it has to be a lot more balanced right now. We wouldn't want to be too or overly defensive beyond a point. I think there's some sectors that are good buy and holds. Pharmaceutical, you know, is something as a sector that we've always been overweight for the last 15 years, I think. And that continues to be a good long-term sector to just hold on to if you get the right names there. But as far as consumers are concerned, again, we don't want to brush the entire sector in with one stroke. But the point is that if you're stock selective, there are good opportunities. But I think this whole re-rating cycle of consumption stocks, of the consumer stocks in particular, I think is pretty much behind us. So, you know, to expect further re-rating is difficult. I think their performance will be very, very sensitive to the earnings growth that they're likely to deliver over the next few quarters. Things continue to look okay for the time being. So, you know, there's no reason to just exit this whole space. But I'd say we have a much more balanced view. If you had to take a 2-3 year view, you'd want to be a lot more balanced, which means not massively overweight defensives and massively underweight cyclicals, but a slightly better balance of the two, because there clearly is value that exists in a lot of the economy sensitive companies, which, you know, are logically doing bad in this scenario. But you know, you've got to assume that somewhere down the road the economy would turn, and then these businesses get the double kicker of valuation as well as a fundamental improvement. So you need to have a balance in a portfolio at any point in time. You can't be skewed extremely one way or the other.
What would you be underweight, Anup, at this point of time? Which sectors?
So, you know, typically when we look at sectors, you know, the basic question we ask ourselves is, you know, is there pricing power in the sector or not? And typically wherever pricing power is under pressure is where you want to be underweight. And, you know, where pricing power is in your favor, you'd like to be overweight. Now, in the current scenario, clearly there are challenges for quite a few companies. I think telecom remains a fairly challenged sector where return on capital ratios have deteriorated significantly. I think, you know, future capex also seems to be again around the corner. And all of these are going to make it quite difficult for companies to, you know, demonstrate the pricing power that we'd ideally like them to see. So that's that continues to be a bit of a challenge sector. Apart from that, you know, you've got within the sort of pricing pressure scenario, the metals sector, from a long-term point of view, in our opinion, is going to go through certain challenges just given the global growth slowdown or the readjustment to a lower rate of growth. So there too, I think structurally it's going to be a little difficult for commodity businesses, which are particularly fully integrated, to do much. So I think, you know, we're clearly again underweight that sector as well. But again, I've got to just qualify all of this with the fact that that's a broad sector view, but there will be individual companies that are positioned slightly differently based on their businesses. So, you know, it doesn't mean you'd be absolutely zero in the sector. There may be some opportunities that still exist within each one.
Would you be fully invested at this point of time, apart from the bit of cash you would normally be keeping at all points of time, Anoop, or would it be a far more cautious approach right now? Again, I'm asking from a 2 to 3 year time frame. Do you think this is a good time to be deploying the money that you have?
I mean, again, with a 2 to 3 year view, our sense is yes, it makes sense to deploy money. We are fully invested. We run portfolios in that form and fashion anyway. That's our mandate. But for an investor, let's say, wanting to take a view on equities at this point, ideally, we'd have liked to see cheaper valuations, to be frank. But it seems to be coming through in the form of a time correction. So hopefully, if the markets still continue to be in this range for some time, then it tends to get cheaper automatically because earnings are growing at about 10% or so. So our sense is with a 2 to 3 year time frame, although, you know, there's nothing imminent in terms of a turnaround in the whole macro situation, and frankly, it may still take another year before we start seeing some more positive signs coming out from the economy. But, you know, the thing about equities is the improvements, you know, whenever the scenario changes, markets can move up in a rather short period of time and cover a fair amount of return that it has sort of not delivered for a while. So it's very, very difficult to time it, therefore. You know, that 1 or 2 month period can just cover for a year or two of return. And, you know, if you're just late into that cycle, it becomes very difficult to invest again, which is why we just tell investors, and, you know, it's been testing times, frankly. For 5 years, investors really haven't seen much returns from equities. But the key in equities is to maintain patience and believe the fact that eventually businesses have to grow. You know, corporate profits will grow. Otherwise, you know, they won't be able to service debt, which is what everybody's running into at this stage. So logically, equities over a longer period of time has to outperform debt, otherwise, you know, businesses won't exist. And considering the fact that the last 5 years has seen very poor returns from equities, you know, as time passes, you actually have to keep getting more constructive than more negative. So therefore, it's a long-winded answer, but, you know, at the end of the day, if over a 2-year, 3-year time frame, or even more actually, you know, clearly it makes sense to be invested in equities. It doesn't make sense to start migrating to other assets at a point like this.
My final question, Anoop, are you beginning to see at all some kind of a pickup in retail investor interest? Do you believe that, you know, at least we now know that the regulator, the government are on the same page, they want to bring the investor back into the market, preferably through the mutual fund route? Are you beginning to see any kind of pickup in sentiment, at least with the retail investor? Are we pretty much where we were?
Well, it's early days. We've got to see. I mean, there have been some good changes, and I think it'll take time for those to come into effect. But the fact of the matter is, retail investor interest picks up in a rising market or in a trending market of some sort. And, you know, so far, frankly, the numbers don't seem to suggest any major pickup, at least till now. But the fact is, these regulations have come in only last week, and we have to see how it percolates down to the system, whether distributors are incentivized enough to go out and pitch or to manage their client assets and to make sure that they're giving them the right advice. But, you know, all of that will come through in terms of investor interest, but our sense is it'll come through slowly. It won't be a sudden rush. I think the larger interest tends to develop once the market itself starts trending more consistently. There are a few catalysts eventually for that. I mean, the biggest catalyst we're looking for is an interest rate reduction at some level and a slight pickup in earnings growth on the other. So I think that combination, if it has to come through at any point in time over the next 2 or 3 years, that itself will be a very strong catalyst for valuation improvement and for investors to step back into equities more actively. So we're pretty hopeful, but at this stage, it's not surprising that retail investors are pretty switched off or turned off from investing heavily into equities.
All right, Anup, we leave it there. Thank you very much once again for coming by and sharing your perspective with viewers here on Bloomberg TV India. Thank you very much.
Sure. Thanks, Vivek.